all, Bash, you've been in Swansea for just about 2 months now, but I think it's pretty easy to forget just how much you've achieved in a relatively short space of time. You're 20, you've played in Germany, you've played for Chelsea's first team, you won the under-19 Euros, you've played in the under-20s World Cup, you scored in the championship, and you're still only 20. So we're going to take a look back at some of those milestones in your career using Instagram pictures. Mm-hmm. So I've done some digging. I liked some pictures from 2018 by mistake the other day. So if you saw that, now you know why. But we're going to go back, start with this picture.
Yeah.
So this is you signing your scholarship with mm-hmm. Chelsea. So I want to talk about your route to getting that to that point.
Yeah.
So you were born in Exeter,
yeah.
but then yeah. you played for Reading's Academy. Mm-hmm. So I was wondering, did you move to Reading just for football, or were you and your family moving anyway?
No, so I was only really born in Exeter. I lived there for like 2 years.
Yeah.
And then my family moved to Reading. So then I've grown up in Reading my whole life.
Like right.
My parents and my family still lived there. And then I wasn't really too much into football, to be honest. When I was in school, up until year two for me, which was 2010 World Cup year.
Right.
And then it started with the match attacks. So, you know, like everyone used to bring in the booklets.
Yeah.
And then one of my boys, he's given me one for free. And he's gone like, look, Bash, just get into football. I know you'll like it. And I was like, nah. In the end, I took it. And I just started collecting. And then I started playing. And then after that, I literally just fell in love, started playing football. And then I joined the team. I can't remember what year that would have been in, but say I was 9.
Yeah.
And then I was playing for them for like 3 months, and then I got scouted for Reading like straight away, and then just signed for Reading.
Have your family been into football as well, or was it just you?
Never. No, I was the only one in my family that was into it. I think that was probably why I was a bit against it when I was little. But to be fair, now they follow what I do. They understand it a little bit more. But like growing up, like even probably to the age of like 17, 18, they weren't really into football.
What do your parents do for work?
My mother, she is in care.
Yeah.
And then my dad is an accountant.
So they must have had to make quite a few sacrifices as well, taking you to training and giving up a lot of their time.
Yeah. They've definitely helped that and supported me and helped me get to where I am today, and I definitely thank them for that.
So you fell out of love with football a bit, got released by Reading,
mm-hmm.
but then you joined Reading Pumas and you were playing with your mates.
Yeah.
Can you talk to us about how the trial with Chelsea came out of that?
Yeah, so I was obviously playing for Reading Pumas, like you said, and the coach at the time, Lennox, his son, Taylor, was playing for Chelsea. And there was a point in the season where I was like to him, look, I'm not gonna lie, I'm not really enjoying it anymore. So maybe it was like February. I kept on falling out of love with football, innit? Like when it was getting too serious, I didn't really like it. And it was quite intense at Pumas because it was a good team like in the region. And I just told him like, look, I'm not really looking to continue. Like, I'm just playing for fun. He's like, look, like if you quit things, then you're gonna become a quitter. Like, no matter what, like, whether you see it as fun or whatever, like, just see it through. And, like, you never know, like, good things can happen when you stick things through and, like, continue. And I don't, at that time, he wasn't alluding to anything. Like, he was just being honest. Like, I think he was just trying to give me a life lesson
because yeah.
I was, like, 14. And then at the end of the season finished. We've come back in. Like, I've just told him, yeah, I'm signing back for next season. Like, I listened to him. Like, we had a good relationship. And he was like, yeah, like, hear this. He called me one day. He was like, yeah, I've got you a trial at Chelsea, like an open trial. I was like, no way. Like, I don't believe you, innit? Like, it was because it was so random. Like, no one had scouted me, which was how it happened at Reading. And I'd never heard of anyone just getting trials at Chelsea. It didn't happen. But yeah, he got me an open trial at Chelsea. It was mad.
And before that, you were a box-to-box midfielder, weren't you?
Yeah.
So it's thanks to him.
Those were the days, man.
You're a centre-back.
I forgot to say that. Yeah, he put me in the trial at centre-back. And I was fuming when I got that. I was like, yo, I'm not a CB. I've just been playing eight for you. Like, I loved like going forward, like making tackles, whatever. But he was like, nah, trust me, you're going to be better at centre-back.
Rest is history.
Yeah, he was right, innit?
So right. Second picture, it's a bit of a random one.
Yeah.
It's you in Ferrari world in Abu Dhabi.
Mm-hmm.
So I've spotted two people here So Dion Rankin and Ben Elliott. Mm-hmm. So you moved into digs with them and with Jamal Musiala.
Yeah.
This must have just
been... Wait, did I say that? Have I told you that? Or you found
out? No, I've done my research. I've been reading, I've been watching interviews. Yeah. So that must have been chaos, all of you under one roof.
Yeah, and there was one more, Max Thompson as well. So it was five of us. And then, so on the top floor, it was me, Dion and Max. So we shared a room for like 3 years, which was mad. And then below was Jamal and Ben. Five of us in a room, like 15, 16-year-old boys, like testosterone flying around everywhere, just like fighting, arguing, like laughing, making noise, whatever. It was some of like couple of the best years of my life for sure. So good.
And your mum was reluctant to allow you to move in, wasn't she?
Yeah. Yeah, I think it was because it all came around so quick. So like, obviously, I finished the season with Pumas, and that coincided with the school year. And then within like 3 weeks or 4 weeks, I'd signed for Chelsea, and then they said to me they want me to go full time. My mum was like, "Whoa, like, like settle down, like just stay at home and like sign for Chelsea because that was an option." But I was like, "Nah, like I can't turn down an opportunity like that." And then I think my dad spoke to my mum, and then she came around in a few days. She was easy with it. And then I ended up moving in. Perfect.
So as well as obviously living with each other, you went into Chelsea school. Mm-hmm. What was that like?
Oh, it wasn't like a normal school. So like, I think quite a lot of the other clubs, so I used to speak to the City boys, they went to an actual school.
Right.
We never actually went to an actual school. So they had like a really good program. They got teachers in and they got some classrooms in the training ground. And then it was just literally my age group doing lessons together every day. So we were training, we're coming in at 7:30 and we're probably leaving at like 8:30, all of us together every single day.
No way.
Yeah, it was mad.
What were you good at in school?
What was I good at? Maths.
Maths, yeah?
Maths was my subject. I think it's because my dad was an accountant or isn't an accountant.
Yeah.
I got the maths brain.
So Jamal Musiala, could you tell at that age, like, he was destined for big things?
Yeah, Jamal's different, man. He's killing it right now. He's killing it. And to be honest, when I first joined, he was going through like, you know, that funny stage that a lot of players go through of injuries when they're like 13, 14, 15. So he had a lot of like hip problems and like, I don't know, like knee problems where he ran a bit funny and that.
Yeah.
You could just see he had like the quality and he would like carry us in games or like, he'd be like limping for like half the game and then just score like two goals in the 90th minute or something. Yeah, he was unbelievable. Obviously, he's killing it.
Yeah. Right, next one is your first ever Instagram post of your international debut. Now, I could spot Jude Bellingham, Harvey Elliott, Charlie Patino.
Yeah, yeah.
We got Liam Delap as well. Just how proud a moment was that making your debut for your country?
That was like, for me, like obviously I signed for Chelsea and then I ended up playing for England like super quick. Like I didn't even know that was a thing. Like before when I was playing on like playing on the park, like Sunday League, whatever, I didn't even know like kids played for England. So I was like, this is mad to me. That feeling was unbelievable. And that now you say the names, like it's even madder because like say I'm still playing with Charlie, Harvey at England, and then like players that like Jude that have gone on to do like amazing things. So yeah, crazy.
Moving on to signing your professional contract at Chelsea. Now, how did you find that transition from being a boy who played football to being a professional footballer and a professional athlete?
I think that is just like a huge milestone for any player because you hear of like all the percentages and all the things of like, oh, only 1% or like less than 1% make it, And I feel like that's the first like feeling that you get of where you've actually like accomplished something in the game of like I've got my first pro contract. Like now I am, you're not a real footballer because you've not like played senior football, but you feel like now like I can actually like make something of myself.
What changes did you have to make to your lifestyle? Obviously, everything comes into it then, from your eating to your sleeping.
Yeah, I think you're definitely more conscious of it. And at Chelsea, they're really good, to be fair. They give us a lot of like they call it football, like education, and they put on sessions for us in like a lecture theatre around like everything you can think of, like diet, like financial stuff. Like obviously it's the first time any of us have seen any kind of money. So like managing that, like houses, like just loads of different things. Like we've done like cooking lessons and all stuff like that. So they're really good.
Who helped you get to this point? And who would you say were the biggest influences on your career, like players and coaches at Chelsea?
I think one of the biggest influences that is still there is Andy Myers. And I'll be curious to see what he thinks if he sees this, because when I was being coached by him, we sometimes had a bit of a hot and cold relationship. And I was his captain, and sometimes we had a few fallings out. And it was a few like really, really important lessons for me that I learned from him, like around character more than anything he taught me, like technically or tactically. It was about like how to be like a good leader and just a good player and how to build trust with your coach and stuff like that. And he's still working with me now while I'm on loan. So yeah, he's been definitely one of those people.
Like from my experience, every player I've come across who has come through Chelsea's academy, they are like good people first and foremost. Like obviously what they do on the pitch speaks for itself, but are them good morals instilled in you from a young age there?
It's because you come across Mark and Connor, that's why they're two of the best people you meet. I think it's important at Chelsea, like one of the main core beliefs there is that you've got to be a good person. And the winning mentality is huge at Chelsea. Like winning is everything, and they say that like being a good person is like what's going to help you get there.
So our next picture is you captaining Chelsea under 21s. Mm-hmm. Do you see yourself as a leader, and what kind of leader would you say you are?
I think I'd see myself as a leader, and I think that's probably changed and evolved a little bit like in the last few years as to what I've done, because obviously, like you said, that was the 21s and I was captain there. And I think at that point, I was one of the more like senior people in the change room. So I was one of the older boys with like slightly more experience. So then it might have been like helping out players and like giving information and stuff like that. And then obviously, as I've gone on loans, I'm no longer that senior player at all. So it's like learning how to be a leader, but then also be someone who learns and takes on information at the same time. So it's a learning progress.
Do you enjoy the responsibility?
I love it. I remember the first time that I was captain for England, like that was an unbelievable feeling, because I wasn't captain at Chelsea before that. And then I just thought like, you just take on that extra bit and you just think, oh, like I'll take control a little bit more and stuff like that. Yeah, I think it helps me play better.
Our next picture, when you won the under-19 Euros with England in Slovakia, just how incredible an experience was that?
Minty is going to hate that picture is involved, because every time he says he sees it at St. George's, he hates seeing my face. that was a sick night. Like, obviously, winning the Euros, it's unbelievable. Like playing for your nation and winning trophies is what you want to do at the end of the day. And that was a really, really good group. Like, we were really, really close, and I'm still close to a few of the boys, so I couldn't be happier winning that.
So Liam Delap is there again. How nice was it to share that success with people you played with all through the age grades?
Yeah, it's cool, man. Like you said, I was with Liam at the start. I was with Patino at the start, who I'm with now. I feel like with the England pathway, like people, it's like a bus, isn't it? Like people like go get on and get off at different stages. So it's cool, like you said, being with Liam from the beginning and then winning something with him at under-19s.
Our next picture is your Chelsea senior debut playing against Man City at the Etihad in the FA Cup. Now, that day you played against the likes of Mahrez, Alvarez, Foden. What was it like lining up in the tunnel next to the likes of them?
Yeah, that was a mad day. I didn't know that I was playing. Like usually you do shape. Like the whole time that I've been with the first team then, you do like shape and you kind of know the team a little bit the day before, or you'd have an idea. And the day before in the shape, like I was on like the side. I didn't think I was playing like whatsoever. I didn't even think I'd be on the bench. And then we did the meeting like an hour and a half, 2 hours before the game, and I was in the starting lineup and I was nervous. Like after that, I was nervous. And I was thinking about it. And then I made a few phone calls like to my missus, to like my dad, spoke to them, like calmed down, and I just kind of realized that I had nothing to lose in the situation. I played thousands of football matches, and it was just another football match. Just go out and play and enjoy myself. And to be fair, when I was lining up, nothing. I didn't really feel any sort of pressure or anything. When I got onto the pitch, it just felt like a normal game. But then in hindsight, it was mad, like, and it was a crazy experience.
And I suppose that was the culmination of years of hard work to get to that point. So, result aside, how did it feel afterwards knowing you'd made your senior debut?
Yeah, I know you said result aside, but I can't ever put it aside. That still burns me now that we didn't win that game. And it was obviously just a tough moment, like, for Chelsea at that point. So it was one of them things. But yeah, crazy. Like, I remember, like, I was with my missus after, and she was like, "Can you believe that you just played for Chelsea first team?" And I was like, "What? Like, that's what I was supposed to do the whole time I was in the academy." She was like, "No, like, you need to understand how mad that is." And like, now I'm learning to, like, appreciate things and moments, like, as they come, rather than waiting until I get years down the line and then looking back on it and I didn't, like, enjoy it at the time.
So Graham Potter was the manager who gave you that debut, someone we obviously know well here. How grateful were you to him for giving you the opportunity?
Yeah, super grateful. Like, at the first opportunity I got, like, the next day, I went and spoke to him and I just, like, thanked him, because for a manager, there's not a lot of upside for putting a young, especially a defender, in. And he just had that trust in me. He said that I'd shown him that I could do well in training in certain games. So he said it wasn't a risk. Like, he was like, "Don't think about it like that. It was never that. You'd earned it, and you'll always earn your opportunities that things aren't given." So I'll always have that sense of gratitude towards him, and hopefully I come across him again in the future.
Next, we have your loan at Paderborn. Now, you had options to go to League One or League Two clubs on loan, but you chose to go for the difficult option of going to Germany. So when I say difficult, I mean new language, new country, different surroundings. How did you find adapting to that and making that step up to men's football?
Yeah, when you say it was, like, the difficult one, yeah, I know what you mean. It was an interesting decision, but I think it came down to the fact of, like, I spoke to a bunch of coaches and they all said the same thing, like, why not do it? Like, it's, you're going safe if you're staying in England, and, like, you can go to League One if you want, like, if Paderborn don't work, like, after. So why not go and, like, see how it goes? And yeah, to be honest, everything went well at the beginning, like, really well. It was smooth. Like, they took real good care of us. Like, they were really good. Like, Robin and Benny were, like, so the directors were looking after us, and it was a great experience, like, from the beginning.
What was the atmosphere like in games? Because whenever you see, like, German football on TV, it looks just a mad atmosphere.
It's even better in real life. It's even better. Like, drums, smoke, like, they have, like, ultra stands there where it's just standing, and you get there and you get out in the warm-up and they're already there. Like, the full ultras are already stood there, like, laughing, whatever, drinking, and they're... The atmosphere is crazy. Like, we went to go watch one Dortmund game against Hertha Berlin, and the away fans, like, brought smoke and smoked out the whole stadium. Like, they had to stop the game for 20 minutes. So German fans are crazy.
You mentioned Dortmund. When you were choosing to go to Germany, was it in your mind of, like, obviously Jude was in Germany, Jamal, like, it was working out for them?
Yeah. Yeah, I think so. I think, and obviously, like, Sancho as well.
Yeah.
I think that they kind of, like, paved the way a little bit in terms of players feeling more comfortable going abroad and, like, going and experiencing things. And I think that it was definitely true, because I got a lot of love when I was out there that I really appreciated.
Right. This one, I just had to get Thiago Silva in there somewhere. I'm forcing it a bit. I've done him dirty with that picture. But obviously, he's one of them players who, he's been there, he's done it, he's got the song named after him. What's it like? How valuable is it being able to learn off someone like him?
It's priceless, really. It's priceless. Like, coming up to train, like, say it's like an 18-year-old, and seeing Thiago Silva, who's one of my idols, like, when I was, I don't know, like 10, 11, 12, I used to watch, like, compilation videos of him before games, trying to get myself amped up, like, oh, like, this is what I'm going to do. Like, if the guy does a step over and goes down the line, then I'm going to make that tackle or whatever. and then like seeing him in the flesh. To be honest, like at the time, like, I didn't really get starstruck. It was mad like that it was Thiago Silva, and then just being like a sponge around him, like learning everything I can off him day to day. Like, what does he do? Like in certain training sessions, like how does he react to this? Like, how does he communicate with that person? Yeah, like I said, priceless.
As well as Thiago Silva, obviously, when you look at the centre-backs who have come through the Chelsea system in recent years, you've mm-hmm. obviously got Mark, Trevor Chalobah, Levi Colwill, Fikayo Tomori. Mm-hmm. Is that encouraging, knowing that you're in a good place in terms of development for you as a player and a centre-back?
Yeah, definitely. I think that coming through an academy, you're always looking to the players that are in front of you, like older than you, like as an example. And I think that I couldn't have had better examples. Like you said, Mark, I've almost copied his career path at the minute. So yeah, hopefully it keeps going well.
Did you speak to Mark and Connor before you came to Swansea?
Yeah, I spoke to both of them briefly. I didn't pry too much, but I didn't need to because what they said was all positive. They just said, just go and smash it. Like you'll enjoy it. Like everyone in the club is lovely. And then that's all you need really to go and like play your best football.
So Mark belongs to the same agency as you. Mm-hmm. Someone else who's involved with that agency is Wayne Routledge, someone yeah. we know very well here. Yeah. Have you spoken to him since you've been in Swansea?
Yeah, I've exchanged a few messages with Wayne. I haven't actually came across him or met him in real life yet, but I'm looking forward to it. Hopefully I'll come across him at some point. But my agents did speak to me about him. They said, yeah, he'll tell you all the best spots, like anywhere you need to go, like stay away from here, stay away from there. But yeah, hopefully I meet him soon.
He knows Swansea better than anyone.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
Right, I'm sorry, but we're going to talk about the Under-20s World Cup. It obviously didn't end the way you wanted it to, mm-hmm. but how big a learning experience was that?
Yeah, I'm still salty about that. Yeah, obviously, in terms of learning experiences, like, an Under-20 World Cup is probably as good as you can get in youth international football. And especially because we went to Argentina and it was super, super hostile. And we didn't know that it was hostile because obviously there's a lot of history there that goes on, but it's not really something that we knew about. And then they're like, yeah, you're the most hated here. Like, so our liaison was like, you're the most hated. And we're like why? And then we got to our game, we started singing the national anthem, just straight whistling, booing, like abuse from the sidelines, like it was, but I loved it, like it was so good. And like, cause it almost felt like it was us, like as a team, like say like 20, 22 players and our coaches and stuff, like against the whole country. And I think that inspired us even more to go on like, and do well. And unfortunately we couldn't do that, but in terms of like the animosity, like the setting, like playing in the World Cup, like in Argentina, yeah. Couldn't have got any better.
I guess that stood you in good stead, really, for whatever atmosphere you come up against now, mm-hmm. whether that's championship or whatever.
Yeah.
You can deal with it.
Yeah, definitely. That's still the most animosity that I've felt. Maybe I'll come up against something. Cardiff.
Cardiff, yeah. This is the picture that kind of gave me the idea for this interview, because mm-hmm. I have never seen an angle like that. It's such mm-hmm. a cool picture. So you were playing for Chelsea in the summer series in America. You lifted the trophy. Mm-hmm. So you played in the games out there too. Yeah. How much did you enjoy that as an alternative to your usual pre-season?
Yeah, I loved it. It was my first time experiencing pre-season with the first team. And I didn't really know what to expect because obviously I came back from loan and I thought I'll probably just be with them before the before we go away, and then I'll go on loan, right? And then they're like, no, like we want you to come with us to America. So I'm like, okay. And then went out and I actually ended up loving it because I ended up playing way more than I thought. And at the end of the day, it's about whether or not you play. Like as a footballer, that's kind of decides whether or not you enjoy something most of the time. But loved it. Like you said, that picture was mad.
I don't know how they got that.
I have no idea. And that game was crazy as well because I think we were in Atlanta, but don't take my word for it, but Almiron used to play for the team.
Right.
So maybe I've got the team wrong.
No,
but where
I think
we
that
were,
sounds right.
Yeah, it was about 70,000 in the stadium and they were all there to support him. And there was also Chelsea fans there, but it was mad.
Crazy.
Great atmosphere for a pre-season game. You wouldn't expect it.
Now, the next picture was the start of a crazy few weeks for you.
Mm-hmm.
So you made your Stamford Bridge debut against Wimbledon in the Carabao Cup.
Mm-hmm.
Was that something you'd always dreamed of, playing at Stamford Bridge?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, coming through the academy, especially when we're at Diggs, we used to go to a lot of games. Like, I went to a few Champions League games. I've seen Messi play at Stamford Bridge, and I think like those are the times where you just think, oh, like, I want to be on that pitch. Like, I don't want to be watching that. Like, I want to be playing. And yeah, I was given the opportunity to play there, and obviously I got to grab it with both hands, and yeah, loved it, loved it.
Just 2 days later, you signed for the Swans.
Mm-hmm.
We'd heard like throughout the month it was a possibility, yeah, that it wasn't.
Yeah.
When did you first realise that it was going to happen?
I think a day before that picture was
really?
Taken. Maybe. Like, so I played the game against Wimbledon, which was kind of what I was waiting for, to then know if I was going to be allowed out. And even then it was still difficult. Like, I had a pretty long conversation with the manager, and then he had to go and like deliberate with everyone else. And then they kind of said, look, we're going to do what's best for you here, not what's best for us, because they wanted me to stay there and kind of be in and around it and play some games. But I said, look, I want to go somewhere where I can play games and like get better and improve. And they said, look, yeah, we want what's best for you. So they said, go Swansea, because we know it's a good place and it's a good club. And like, go there and hopefully play some good football.
And how have you found the club and the facility so far?
Yeah, loved it. I loved every minute, really, since I've came. Apart from the fact that I had to come and then leave,
yeah,
straight away, because I wanted to be in and around it. But then since then, I feel like it's just been about absorbing things as quick as possible, getting to know the area. And then now I feel like I'm embedded within the team. Like, I know everyone well. I know all the coaches, all the staff and that. And I'm, yeah, loving it.
And you're finally getting to see some of the local area as well.
Yeah, finally. It's about time. I thought he was trying to make me drive off some cliffs around here.
Does it help? Like, when you were deciding to come here, did it help knowing you were coming to a club that has a track record of giving young players a chance and developing them?
Yeah, of course. I think loan territory can be quite scary when you're selecting what team to go to, because you just don't know, like, a lot of, and it's the, like, this is the harsh reality, a lot of managers sell dreams to loan players because they just want you to come and they don't know whether they're going to like you or not, but they want you to come because they've heard, like, oh yeah, he's going to be good. But I really trusted what Swansea was saying to me when I spoke to Paul and Gaffer, obviously. Like, I really trusted what they were saying, and I think it was quite an easy decision.
Then, after signing for Swansea, you had your first call-up to England under-21s. I guess that was another milestone checked off the career checklist.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. I think, well, I can't speak for other players, but every season, or even less, maybe every 6 months, like, I set a little goal tree for myself and like things that I want to tick. And that goes down to like small things, whether it's just like playing this game or like doing a certain amount of things for the week. And that was a big one. Like, this season, I wanted to make some appearances for England under-21s because, like you said, that's a big milestone. And then that's as close as I can get to the first team before I make that big step. So yeah, hopefully just rack up as many games for them as I can this season.
The milestones keep on coming. You were then called up to train with England's first team. Mm-hmm. Now, we spoke about being starstruck around Thiago Silva. Was that just a mad experience turning up and training with all of them? Like, I know you're used to training with Chelsea's, yeah, first team, but mm-hmm, what was that like?
Yeah, I think that it was less about who was there and it was more about the fact that it was England senior team. Like, that is almost the pinnacle. That is as far as I can go in that setting. Do you know what I mean? Like, I can't literally push any further. So just the feeling of course, I've not been called up, but the fact that they know me as a player and that they've trusted me to come and train, and the fact that I can get myself in front of them is, yeah, it's so important, like, for me as a player. And like, obviously, I just enjoyed every second of that session.
It must have been a whirlwind because you've gone from playing for the under-20s, mm-hmm, then to the 21s, mm-hmm, and now all of a sudden there's a, yeah, whole new squad.
Yeah, no, do you know what? That taught me a lesson, to be fair, because obviously I'd been with the 20s at the World Cup, and then to be called up for the 20s again wasn't exactly what I wanted, because I wanted to be pushing up to the 21s like you would. And the manager, Joe Edwards, of the 20, said to me, look, don't turn down opportunities because you never know. And he was 100% right, because like you said, I got bumped up two levels in a day. And if I'd have been like a bad professional and said, oh, like, I don't want to go 20s, like, I want to go to Swansea, da da da, like, that never would have happened.
We're on to our last milestone, your first senior goal against Norwich. How would you describe that feeling of scoring in front of Jack Army?
Yeah, so that was so, that was just an unbelievable feeling. I remember you asked me after the game, obviously, and I couldn't describe it then. And now even, it was just so good to like get the winner in the game, do you know what I mean? Like, I've had a few chances. You said it's my first senior goal, like, I've hit the woodwork, like, I've hit the post, I've missed sitters. And to finally get the goal and for it to be at home, like, tops it off, 100% tops it off.
Has it just made you hungrier for even more goals?
Yeah. To be honest, I'm not really like too fussed about goals, but it's definitely made me hungrier for wins, because that was one of the first wins that I got, like, for the club. And the feeling of winning, like, as a team is unmatched. Like, everyone's just buzzing. Like, the vibes when you get back into the change room are good. Like, you come in on a Monday and everyone's feeling good. Like, that's the feeling I'm chasing, really.
What would you say are your hopes now for the rest of the season?
Well, I think it's to get to the Premier League at the end of the season. That's got to be my hope. Like, that's got to be the goal, really, to just build momentum, keep improving, and then, yeah, end up in the Premier League at the end of the year.
Well, I'll have to track you down in, say, 5-10 years' time and see how many more milestones you've ticked off. But thank you for joining us today, and thank you to The Lighthouse for having us.
Yes, thank you. Thank you to The Lighthouse for having us, and yeah, thank you for having me, Sophie.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.